Hello, I'm Sri Ganesan. I'm one of the medical oncologists over at the Rutgers Cancer Institute of New Jersey, where I see patients with breast cancer. I also run a basic and translational lab focused on DNA repair and cancer genomics. I'm delighted to be talking to you today.
We have different kinds of diseases. Now, what is we talking about when we talk about cancer?
Uncontrolled growth of the cells.
Well, let's say I give you some thyroid-stimulating hormone and your thyroid takes off. You get a big goiter. Can make you sick, but we don't consider that cancer. What are other features?
Is there always a mutation in the genome?
Actually, as you get older, we just sequence like random cells in your skin. I can start seeing clonal mutations, but we don't consider those people to have cancers.
I believe that it's an undifferentiated cell type.
Imagine that you can have embryonic rests of undifferentiated cells that can persist in adulthood. Some people say metastasis. It has to grow and has to spread. But then, think about endometriosis. That's basically metastasis of the normal lining of the endometrium to the peritoneal cavity, and that can make people sick. The reason I'm saying this is really hard to define cancer. Cancer really is not a disease. It's a pathological clinical state that's comprised of many thousands of distinct disease entities. It's characterized by unrelenting, disorganized growth of cells and tissue. And that does not respect tissue boundaries and left untreated this will make you sick. Infection also describes a pathologic clinical state that's comprised of many different distinct disease entities. So people often think, when are we going to cure cancer, right? So it's like saying, what's the treatment for infection? When are we going to cure infection? And so just like bacterial pneumonia and HIV are both considered infections, and no matter how much you study bacteria, you're not going to get the treatment for HIV or vice versa. But there is one hallmark, which is really the presence of acquired changes to your genome that make you sick. If infection really is someone else's genome, someone else's DNA or RNA that make you sick, why do we have cancer? So we live long lives because we're constantly rebuilding ourselves. And so imagine like for our skin, we have hundreds of millions of skin cells. Some of them are dying all the time, being shed off on our surface. So we're constantly slowly making new ones to replace the ones that are dying and shed off. In every organ, there is a lineage of stem cells can make more of themselves. Those progenitor cells can make more of themselves and also differentiate. And ultimately then form the well-differentiated cells that make each of our organs. If you think of any given organ and they're made up of differentiated cells that do the job of that organ, whether it be secretion, contracting the muscle, whatever. Over time, some of them die, but we don't rebuild them by the nearby neighboring cell dividing into two. The same thing, imagine you have a city. We have lots of differentiated people like doctors and lawyers and plumbers. And every day that some doctors and engineers and plumbers are dying. But the nearby doctors don't divide into two. What happens is that undifferentiated cells, like your cells, are slowly coming in, differentiating into those roles. We're in a kind of equilibrium, right? In which the number of dying cells is made up by growing cells. And during early childhood, where you're literally growing, and so more cells are being made than are dying. Most of our adult life, this is in balance. As we get older and we start running out of stem cells, or they're not working as well as they should, our organs literally wither. In tissues with a lot of cell turnover, where we have a lot of cell death going on, like the skin, the gut, or the bone marrow, where the stem cells will make up a large portion of tissue, you can find them. But in other tissues that turn over very slowly, like our brain and our heart, there the stem cells will make a very small proportion of those tissues. People often think, hey, the fundamental cancer is too much growth. So let's do the experiment. Take one of these early progenitor cells and make it grow more. As long as differentiation is intact, what will happen is these guys will make more themselves, but ultimately they'll differentiate, right? And you'll enter a new equilibrium where there's just more stuff. And in fact, we see that these are hypoplastic states. So in certain diseases like chronic myelogenous leukemia, where you get lots and lots of differentiated cells, are really hyperplasias as opposed to real cancers. Instead of causing growth, let's just block differentiation. You'll see what happens. Then you'll build up these cells that can make more of themselves, but they can't differentiate to create the functional cells of the organ. And that really is the cancer. So it's really the accumulation of normal cells that can't differentiate and can't die. These undifferentiated cells look like the progenitors in any tissue. So if they spread to other tissues, they'll get taken up and nurtured. Now the question is, you know, we have trillions of cells. Why doesn't cancer occur more frequently? When a cell enters cell cycle, all the signals that come in for cell division have to come in exactly correct at the right time and right order. And if anything comes out of place, if there's a DNA damage or a growth signal that's wrong, you suddenly get these alerts that come on and say, kill the cell. But unfortunately, what often happens is that that exact alarm system is one of the things that gets mutated. In order for tumors to survive, they have to grow, not differentiate, and not die. Now, what is the most common source of genomic mutations?
UV radiation.
I was going to say also carcinogens.
So, hey, you know, exogenous mutagen. But let's say we can remove all these carcinogens from our environment. Will we still get cancer? And what would be the source of mutations?
Is it just like a DNA replication error?
Absolutely. So DNA replication is the most common source of genetic mutation. We know, for example, that smoking causes lung cancer, as well as other diseases of the lung. People always think, hey, if we can identify that carcinogen in tobacco that causes cancer and eliminate it, we can make a safe cigarette. But it's an irritant. And all it does is it makes your well-differentiated lung epithelial cells, instead of living for 30 days until they die, they now only live for like 5 or 6 days. So all you've done is just increase the death rate. So what's your body going to do? The lung is going to start making more cells. So in that 1 year smoking, you're going to go through 5 years worth of the replication, the mutagenesis. And you're also going to prematurely age the organ because you're running through your stem cells. With that in mind, what do you think is the most common risk factor for cancer?
Is it aging?
Absolutely. Okay, the major risk factor of cancer is age. So there's certain childhood cancers that don't increase with age, like osteosarcomas. What do you think that is?
Could it be just because that's something where when you're younger, the growth is more rapid and then it slows down?
Absolutely, not even slows down. Those cells that grow bone only exist in childhood and or in the fetus and don't exist in the adult. People often think of cancer as kind of being autonomous. But in fact, you know, most cancers cannot grow outside the body. So these are histologic specimens. The big cells are the tumor cells. And here, for example, this is blue, right? It's all these lymphocytes. It's that mixed with all these lymphocytes. And the thing is growing in this kind of microenvironment. Here, the tumor cells now has a red environment. This is because all these fibroblasts are making this hyaline. All right, these are both cancer cells, but their microenvironments are very different. And you take them out of there, they actually don't grow. All right, so they're not truly cell autonomous. They've somehow tricked their environment or themselves into being able to grow with the local environmental cues. If you guys have read the book, you know, the HeLa cells, it was actually a big time. It was the first time we got a cancer cell to grow outside of the body. Now, how is cancer diagnosed? You know, how do you know they have cancer as opposed to anything else?
Don't you take a biopsy of the growth?
Right. And then how do you get the cancer diagnosis?
You sequence the biopsy to see if there's any alterations to the genome.
So that's a very new thing, right? Cancer still to this day is diagnosed by the visual examination of tissue histology. You know, so this is what normal tissue is, and cancer looks different. What are the classes of cancer? The classification of cancer right now is dominated by anatomy, where the lump arises, and histology, what it looks like under the microscope. If you have a lump in the lung, you take a piece of it and it doesn't look right, say that's lung cancer. Then they look at it, and this is how we classify it. If the cells are small, it's small cell lung cancer. If the cells aren't small, it's non-small cell lung cancer. Because non-small cell lung has a certain pattern of morphology, they call it adenocarcinoma. If it has a different pattern of morphology, it's squamous cell carcinoma. And then you have a bunch of other types. So if you now do sequencing, they go, say, what are the genomic changes? For example, if you look at non-small cell adenocarcinoma, you see that that presents an enormous heterogeneity of underlying genomic events that are driving the cancer. So for example, 3 to 4% of non-small cell adenocarcinoma will have rearrangements in a tyrosine kinase called ALK, anaplastic lymphoma kinase. Those cancers, and only those cancers, are highly responsive to the ALK inhibitor, crizotinib. It's a great drug. Is it a lung cancer drug? Well, 96% of lung cancers will not respond to the ALK inhibitor. When people are diagnosed with cancer, what you really want to know is what are the genomic alterations and can we therapeutically target those? And this is really important because there are a whole host of drugs that we've developed that target different signaling pathways, and they only work when there's evidence of mutation and thus pathway addiction in the tumor. How to really identify and classify cancers? Is it by phenotype, the histology, what the cells look like, genotype, mutations and other genomic pathways, epigenotype, patterns of DNA modifications, and then ultimately we're talking about the host response. Maybe two different people can get the genetically identical cancer, but have different host responses to that